Hello there, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, dogs and cats, frogs and rats, and of course, everything in between. My name, as I'm sure you all know and are familiar with at this point, is Genosad. And today I'm joined with Homeless Man. How are you?
Yes, how's it going? I am the rogue Anon. I do CSGO videos, and that's just about it. I do gaming videos.
Fantastic.
How's it going?
Pretty well. Kind of, you know, locked myself up in my house due to the whole COVID thing going on, but honestly,
yeah. Like,
even with that going on, I really don't care. Like, this is how I prefer to live, inside all the time, so it'll be fine.
Should I take off my fucking microphone? I'm gonna hold my microphone. I'm a newscaster.
You an audio
so this is live, right?
No, it's not live. It's just, you know, I record it, and then I do some editing for an intro, then an outro. And then I, yeah.
Put it on YouTube. All right. I just want to make sure I don't say anything, like, fucked up and get your channel taken down.
Oh, you can say whatever the hell you want. This is a normal conversation with a normal person. So whatever you might say that's normal to a conversation, go ahead and say it. I don't really mind all that much.
Okay. So, like, some people are very particular about it, especially when it comes to YouTube. And I can sort of understand it, but for me, it's like, YouTube is solely a hobby. I don't plan on getting famous from it. I don't, you know, go out of my way to try to, you know, get people to watch my videos all the time. Like, if it comes up and people want to see my channel, I'll fucking, I'll be like, here's my channel. It's not anything special. I'm not huge. Don't let me fucking go on about that, because I went on, like, all night last night for, like, 3 hours about these people that I, about this group of commentary creators that I ran with. Like, God.
Yeah. So, well, actually, I guess that's a pretty good way to segue into the whole you doing YouTube thing, right? So, right now, like, as you are, you kind of act as if you already are, like, you know, kind of a regular content creator. Like, you know what it is that you make and how you make it and that kind of stuff, right?
Yeah, to a certain extent. I just don't really care to be... I like it as a hobby. I like meeting people and collabing with people. It's really fun. Social networking site, but I also know the implications of the fact that people do. I would never have this as a job, and I wouldn't recommend it, right? Especially nowadays at the current climate, due to how fucking just absolutely unstable the system is. Another thing, YouTube released a tweet that I saw saying that since the coronavirus is keeping people indoors and they don't have as many people manually reviewing videos, they said, and I quote, more videos are going to be taken down even if they violate any of the guidelines.
Even so if they don't violate full- them?
Yeah, they literally
Jesus
said that. And they
Christ.
Said, we apologize in advance. And it's like, if you know your system is that flawed, do more the fix-its. Don't fucking sit there and tell people that your videos are going to go down, because that is absolutely bullshit. People make money from that. And that's what gets on my nerves the most, because there are content creators that get fucked over by that.
That's true, actually. I mean, there's and it wouldn't even be that hard for them to work from home, right?
Because it really wouldn't.
If your job is YouTube, you know, your job is monitoring a site or moderating a site, just making stuff be not there and other stuff be there. And honestly, that's something you could do from home. That's something that I do every day of my life, you know, whenever I'm on Discord, just like, oh, hey, look at what's going on here, you know?
Yeah, they're basically fucking site admins, so they could work from their personal computer. I really think that YouTube is taking this as an opportunity to unfairly take down people's videos. Mm-hmm. I'm fully behind that idea, because
yeah, it wouldn't be far-fetched either.
Actually, I mean, they have made themselves to be non-transparent.
That is true. They've kind of have you ever heard of the Dog Tower, I think it's called, the Twitter account? Basically,
no.
There's this Twitter account called, like, Watchdog Tower, something like that. And what it is that, you know, it kind of exposes some of the inner workings of YouTube. And one of the more recent things, and I say more recent, it was like about a year ago, maybe a bit longer than that, was that, you know, they had actually held like a private meeting to kind of take to kind of take more what they called unwanted YouTube accounts and just kind of do what they could to, you know, make their viewership go down or make them inactive and, you know, stuff like that. And the names included on this, right? Well, first I should say, even though that this leak came out about a year ago, the actual event took place sometime in 2016, right? And among these unwanted YouTubers that they listed were Grade A Under A. Tell me, do you see any videos by him?
No.
Leafy is here. Tell me, do you ever see any videos by him?
Yeah, he fucking disappeared off the earth.
Yeah, and I think there were a couple of other channels named there, but, you know, ones that I weren't really too familiar with and didn't really stick out enough for me to actually care. I think Onision was actually on. Yes, Onision was on that list, too. Have you recently seen any Onision videos?
Fuck, I don't watch Onision.
Exactly! Nobody watches these people. And I think Onision, like, he wasn't exactly in... excuse me. Like, 2016 wasn't exactly his heyday, right? Because that was well before 2016. However, he, like, that was also around the time when he was actually doing some really controversial shit. And Leafy is here was already a controversial member. And, you know, Keemstar and Grade A Under A, like, they were all kind of, like, wrapped up in the same kind of shit that Leafy was doing.
Oh, no, they, all three of them were friends. I've been watching the Misfit.
And then they weren't.
Yeah, I was watching the Misfit podcast, or clips of it, and they were interviewing Keemstar. Excuse me. And he was telling them how they had created a kind of a circle of friends, and how when everyone was attacking Keemstar after the concert, because they, even though they were fucking bringing up his old troll clips and, you know, saying, oh, he's a racist, he right. beats his girlfriend, you know, with no fucking actual evidence behind it. And they actually almost ended up making him quit. And I think you do make a good point. I think that did have something to do with Grade A and Leafy leaving. But also the other thing was that Leafy knew that the commentary community wasn't like the reaction commentary videos weren't going to be a full thing.
Well, that's the thing. He still kept on going, but the thing is that, you know, his videos just didn't get any attention at all.
Oh, it's kind of like Aiden Projects. Like, if you go to his channel, he, the last time he uploaded was like a month or two ago, and it was the same fucking shit he was doing after Keemstar gave him the shout out, and he's just not doing anything anymore because even he knows that those kinds of videos are just not they're not popular anymore.
Yeah.
You know, and I repetitive and just and you don't get a whole lot out of them.
A lot of that is because of that, you know, whole demonetization thing that goes on too, and I don't know. so let's talk about you for a moment here, yeah? So let's see here. How exactly did you get your whole YouTube, how did you get into the YouTube hobby, I should ask?
It started when I was in high school, and we had just moved into the apartments for and we were there for about a year. I'd finished up my middle school years, and then I came into Oak Hills, and I got more into watching YouTubers like, at first it was Vanos Gaming, Markiplier, PewDiePie, those sorts of people. And so what I wanted to do is I wanted to make gaming content. So what I did was I took this shitty fucking phone that I got from like Kroger's or something, put it in front of my TV and played games like Black Ops 2 and GTA 5 and Minecraft with really no commentary. They were boring as fuck. But, you know, it's what I enjoyed doing at the time. It wasn't until PewDiePie with Dylan the Hacker where I started making, where I started delving out and making rant videos. They weren't good. They were stupid. And I did not know at the time that Dylan the Hacker was faking the videos because I was stupid.
I do remember you having that. Like, I guess you, like, reacted to your own... Or you didn't react to it. I guess you commentated to it, your old video where you talked about it. It was honestly hilarious to me because, like, when I was watching that, I was like, oh, yeah, this guy's obviously a troll, you know?
I didn't know that. I was still very, very new to YouTube. And even during the commentary community, I still had thin skin. So when people would fuck with me, I'd take it personally, which was... very stupid.
I mean, hell, there's always Poe's law, right? Which basically just says, unless somebody distinctly says that they're joking on the internet, it's very hard to tell whether or not they actually are, right? Like, for example, sarcasm through text. Like, how the hell do you know whether or not somebody's being sarcastic when they're typing something out? Unless they, like, you know, throw in a lot of, how should I say? Like, you know, if somebody says, if somebody types out sarcastically, oh, yes, I am a pedophile. If somebody says that sarcastically, you can't really get through that unless you said, unless you make it hyperbolic, like, oh, of course, 100% there is no doubt about it that the fact that I am a pedophile and that is 100% true. Do not think that it's fake. I don't know. Like, if you were to, like, make it into a hyperbole, that's the only way you can tell that, like, somebody is actually being sarcastic.
The way you could tell would be like, oh, I'm a pedophile. I've molested over 100,000 kids in one week.
Right.
You know, something like that. That'd be the only way you can tell that it was sarcastic. But, you know, I get what you're saying. It is kind of hard for people, especially now, whether or not someone's joking or not, because there are people who go on there and make their online personas, you know, one giant, and sometimes people still can't tell.
And
that was the case with Dylan the Hacker, where there were a sizable amount of people, myself included at the time, who thought he was serious, who genuinely didn't like him, who genuinely wanted to see him fall. And honestly, looking back on it, I think it's a beautiful thing that he did. But he had passed. I was surprised to hear about that. He didn't even. I don't even think he lived to be 20.
Jeez.
Yeah. It went under the radar. PewDiePie kind of made one tweet about it, but it really flew under the radar because his family didn't want, you know, all of that to be out there, because there are still people who think he's surprisingly. And you know, I guess his family knew what he was doing online. It didn't really want the details of his death coming out, but no, he's dead. Pretty sad to hear about, honestly. He was a pretty funny guy.
I bet that must be something to, that really hit him hard, honestly. I remember,
I ended up joining the commentary community shortly after all of the, I made all the fucking Dylan the Hacker videos and I'd taken them down. Me creators making videos on them, using like a power director on the phone and using a recorded CSGO gameplay. And then delve into, well, I actually got criticized, especially taking YouTubers out that I thought I could use some criticism. Mm-hmm. And at the time, I was still using my phone, but what I was doing were up in my room, basically towards a wall, and, you know, commentating on it. And you could still see, like, my old channel's still up with a good sizable amount of the videos that I liked or thought that people would still want to watch.
That ain't good. Give us a second, folks.
Kind of figured your internet cut out.
Okay, there we go. All right, we're back.
Hold on, let me see. No, I'm at 27. Okay, yeah. And my side's good, so.
Okay, just, yeah. Bandwidth is gonna go down when everybody's inside. Staying away from that CV. Yeah. So, your time in the commentary community, what was that like?
Alright, if we're gonna go into that, I'm gonna have to tell you about the whole hypo-waste incident. So, around the time, Kaz, and I was talking to him about making a series called My Thoughts On, which is what my channel was sort of most known for. They would get the most views.
Talking with who? I'm sorry, it cut out again.
Oh, it's a YouTuber named Kaz, who doesn't do anything anymore. Yeah, right. He's sadly not doing anything anymore, but I genuinely hope the best. But he was like, hey, if you're doing that, you know, do you think you can criticize me? And I'm, all right, fuck it, I'll start him. And I don't know, I might have made a My Thoughts On video before that, but I ended up doing a video. And it did well. You know, he took the criticisms,
yeah,
you know, pretty well. And then I get a comment from a guy named Hypo, or ex-HypoWastyX at the time. And he wanted me to do my thoughts. I didn't know him, so I took this opportunity to be a little more vulgar and throw some, you know, throw a few punches, you know, try to be funny, try to bring some respect. And it did pretty well, although ex-HypoWasty did not take the criticisms lightly. He thought I was too harsh, which it was the point. And at the time I thought it was really stupid that he took it so harshly. So he made a video called Shit Small Commentators, and he had put me in there. The only thing he said about me was that I didn't use thumbnail. That's it. And then made a joke because Kaz at the time was I think like 14, and I was like 16 or 17 or some shit like that.
Oh
no, I think I was 16, and I ended up saying I love you, Kaz, as a joke, and he played the clip out of context and then put like the the sex offender shuffle, the sex offender.
Oh yes,
like that after. The thing is, I was still new, and I took it sort of personally, and so I kind of thought people were actually going to think I was a pedo. So I get invited to make this video by a guy named MXNBD. Mm-hmm. He's making a huge video, exposed a lot of shit, apparently. And if you're curious, I still have the live video up. Where like halfway through I ended up talking to some of the people that I was in the commentary community with at the time, and we ended up just going through like the entire video and actually debunking a lot of the shit that was said in the video, because a lot of it was flawed looking back on it now. But at the time everyone was, you know, on this hate train to make a video on HypoWasty. So it was me and like four other YouTubers plus Max making this, or no, five YouTubers plus Max, all making like our separate little videos to put into 3-minute colossal fucking and it did well. It got a lot of attention, and it went well for everything was pretty well up until I mixed it PD. Got into this drama with Aiden Project right before trailer. Then it turns out he gets scammed by Chubbs. Aiden Project gets blown up, and they're still having this little beef between each other. It gets resolved, and Aiden Project gives a shout out to MXNBD. And instead of telling us that he had switched to another channel and he's switching up his content, he deleted his videos and fucked off to another channel out to like. And when we called him out for it, he just treated us like absolute shit. Some of these people were actually friends with him for quite a long time, and he just fucked them right off. And I think at that, that's when I kind of realized that I should just stick by myself when it comes to this. I don't need to be in some sort of community. Commentary community was so fucking cancer. Like, even when we were making the video, the environment that we worked in was fucking hostile. Like, I was constantly getting the arguments with two other people that we were working with on the video, because they were so annoying. They were so unfunny. And the thing is that their parts in the video are insane. Like, all they do is make jokes. All they do is talk shit about the gameplay, and all they do is kind of call it channel shit. Without any, like, they don't refute anything that he said. They don't criticize him in any way. They just make fun of him, and then that's the end of their clip.
Yeah, I can see how that can be frustrating. And like, a lot of people, too, like, when it comes to commentary, they're just like, oh, all I have to do is just insult this dude, and then I'll be popular, I'll be famous, like the big old Leaf Man.
And sometimes it works, like, Loki, who's a fucking asshole, ended up getting exposed and is now making shitty rap music.
Oh, God.
Yeah, it's bad. He has, like, 200,000 subscribers. He gets, like...
I mean, you could have just said rap music, and I would know exactly how bad it is.
Oh, come on.
Okay, you know what? All right, old school hip-hop I enjoy. A Tribe Called Quest, they make some good music, but...
Hey, come on, like, you can't do that. Like, there's some pretty good ones. Like, you ever heard of Lil Durky? He's a pretty versatile rapper. So, probably one of my favorites by now. He's smaller, but he's more up-and-coming than, you know, a lot of people in the indie rap community. He does, like, a lot of shit. But I'm not gonna get into that. It's just one of my favorite artists.
Do you just how like into rap are you now? I'm just a little bit curious. That's all.
I'm very picky about rap artists. Like, I think the only three people I listen to currently are actually four people. I listen to Joyner Lucas, Old School Eminem, X, and Lil Dark.
Seriously, X? Ugh, God, I can't stand that guy.
I love his music. Well, most of his good stuff. Like, he has some pretty fucking cancerous shit.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's more or less like I have a wide variety of music that I'm into, so I can't really explain the types of genres that I listen to, because I kind of have this thing where if I find a song, I just listen to it.
Oh, I like it. I see that. Yeah, I can be more or less the same way sometimes, you know. Like, what I do, like, when I listen to music, I kind of listen to it in terms of mood and tone, right? But a lot of other people listen to it in terms of genre. So, you know, I'll be playing, like, I don't know. I'll be playing something like Mississippi Queen by Mountain, right? And then somebody be like, oh man, you're playing some good music. And then right after that, I'll play something like, you know, something a little bit more like Daft Punk, you know?
Yeah.
And it has the same kind of tone, the same kind of emotion. But because the genres are so different, people will be like, whoa, what just happened? You were listening to something that was just completely different. And I'm just like, oh, no, dude. It's like, and with me, I'm like, no, it's pretty much the same tone, the same emotion. You know, so that's what I really listen to in music. I don't listen much to genre.
I'm more of a I can get behind the whole mood thing, but I'm more of a lyric kind of guy. Like, yeah, like I like to listen to people's stories. Like X, even if you don't like him, you have to say that some of his stuff was good, relatively speaking. Like he put his life out there. Even if it was exaggerated. And it's the same thing with Lil Durky. It's the same thing with Old School M. You know, they threw their troubles out there. They put their emotions out there. And they did it in such a way, for the most part. They did it in such a way where you could really get behind it. And you could really feel the emotions that they were producing.
Yeah. That was, like, the point of classic rap music, or not classic, I should say, but, you know, traditional old school rap and hip hop was, you know, it was all based on, you know, being in, you know, being in this low income community and like resorting to these violent deeds in order to just get by, like that Talib Kweli song. But after a while, you know, you got stuff like NWA and Notorious B.I.G. where like you have people who they're not talking about it because it's a sad truth. They're talking about it and they're glorifying it. And that's like that's what I don't like about like most modern hip hop songs is because they glorify violence rather than going on about how it's something that they, you know, need to resort to because of how the conditions are out there.
And that's why I listen to Lil Darkie. He doesn't tout this like mentality where it's like, oh, I get all these bitches, I get all these drugs. Like there's a song that he made, it's called I'm Addicted to Drugs and I'm Tired of It.
Wow.
You know, he puts it out there that, you know, you shouldn't glorify, you know, violence. You shouldn't glorify drugs. He touts more of a let's not see race, let's see people. Let's not go against each other. Let's stop fighting each other. Let's just have peace. That, like, even if, like, his music is a lot of his music is very violent in nature,
right.
But it's intended because that's what grabs people's attention, and that's really how he's feeling. And I can get behind that entirely because that's how I feel a lot of the time about it. Just everybody is just so against each other. Everyone is just fighting each other,
right.
And I'm sick of it. I am sick of it. And when I listen to his music, I can hear how sick of it he is too, and I can get behind that.
Yeah, that's how things are, man. Do you ever? Here's like a little bit of a question that kind of relates to this actually. Do you ever like, maybe like you're listening to music and like as you listen to something like instrumental, like you start in your head to like come up with like a, you know, maybe like a rap or a rhyme or something like that to go along with it?
I'll do that where I'll have people will think I'm weird because so I'll go from like something from the Doom soundtrack to like to XXXTentacion and then I'll switch to like fucking like German and shit.
Oh, German.
Like my shit's so
okay. German's music is actually really good.
Yeah. I'm not saying it's bad. It's just like it's a fucking wide.
Right. Right.
But sometimes I'll like sometimes I'll listen to beats and shit. Like I'll have beats mixed into there where I'll just kind of like listen to them and come up with my just off the spot.
Yeah.
Some of it's not good, some of it's just like, you know, random shit I'm thinking of offhand. Some of it's pretty fucking funny and I usually forget the lyrics. But it gives me sort of a distraction, especially when I'm doing something tedious or annoying and I can listen to the music while I do it. Helps.
Yeah. I can see, yeah, I can definitely see how that would be, you know, a thing. Sometimes I do the same thing, you know, like, mostly just if I'm listening to something a little more lo-fi and, like, I'm just already chilling. And, like, sometimes, you know, with lo-fi music, like, sometimes it really, crosses over to the hip-hop territory. Which, like, sometimes when it does that, I just kind of, like, listen to it, and I'm just like, oh, yeah, I can rap to this, you know? And most of it all is really just, like, a repetition of the same lines, because I can't really make up things on the fly. I'm not that good at it.
Yeah, it depends on, like, how tired I am or how I'm feeling at the time. Like, if I'm probably angry, my lyrics would probably be more violent and, just absolutely just like chaotic to a certain extent. Like if I ever started making music, like I've always toyed around with the idea of making music, and I still am, you know.
Do you have software that you can use? Or
I think I have Audacity, and then like I have a fuck ton of video editing softwares. Like I legally acquired Sony Vegas 17, After Effects, and Premiere Pro.
You're better off than I am. I'm using Vegas Pro 14.
Oh.
That was the only version never mind, that I could afford, we'll say. Anyway, yeah, I never actually bothered to update it, so I just kind of, I'm just kind of sitting around here with that, missing out on the, what is it called, motion tracing.
You're not missing out on much. It's the same. If you're really gonna go and get an editing software, like another one, just get something like Premiere Pro or After Effects. Like,
yeah, I've heard that After Effects is much better, but you know,
it really is.
The only reason, like, I'm not joking, the only reason I use Sony Vegas is because that's what Emp Lemon uses, and that's it. That's the only reason.
I sometimes watch Emp Lemon.
Emp Lemon, like, yeah. Have you seen his Leafy is here videos, or Leafy was here videos?
I think so. Oh. I think I went on a binge of like people who were making videos on Leafy and where he was at. Like, it wasn't Jay Aubrey. Fuck, I watched somebody. Hold on, I'm gonna look up Leafy's tier because it might actually come up.
Leafy's channel won't come up. I mean, it's not like one of the first things that comes up. You have to really scroll down to get it. Because that's kind of what they do.
Leafy returns to YouTube to talk about Nick Avocado. What?
Wait, what? How long ago was this? Oh, a month ago?
Yeah.
Interesting.
Leafy is here too, I bet. Wait, what?
No. Don't tell me that he's already back.
No.
Is it a troll? Is it a...
I think it's a...
Okay.
Everybody.
It's... Oh, okay. So I think it was Leaf Geographic. I think that was the video that
YouTube
I saw.
Geographic, yeah.
So I recognize the thumbnail.
Yeah, no, but yeah, he also did one, a follow-up video to that where he talked to people who had recently been in contact with Leafy. Or at least one guy had been recently in contact with him, but you know, two people. One was, I don't want to say a longtime friend of. Well, yeah, one of them was Colossal is Crazy, right? Who was like, he was that guy who always defended Leafy, unless he did something that really was indefensible. You know, then Colossal would really just kind of be like, eh. But you know, other than that, he almost always defended Leafy, and you know, after that, he also reviewed somebody. I think it was Chris. Chris C, something like that. And he said, like, if Leafy were to return to YouTube, he'd probably be the same. But the thing is, like, he had recently, or at the time of that video coming out, he had been contacted by Leafy about, like, a week before, within the range of 3 weeks before. I don't remember how many exactly. But anyways, he, yeah, like, he had recently been in contact with Leafy and basically said, you know, that, like, if Leafy were to come back, he'd probably be most likely the same kind of person, I guess, you know?
So still a piece of shit?
Probably,
He was a piece of shit.
But, like, at the same time, though, like, he does regret, like, a lot of what he's done, right? Like, the guy who had autism.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, like, what he did to him, like, he took all those videos down, and, like, he issued an apology, like, and that was a heartfelt one, you know? A lot of people kind of, like, a lot of people go and they'll say, you know, like, oh, that you're just making that apology video to make yourself look good. And, yeah, a lot of the time, that is what people do. But with his, like, it was genuine, you know? It wasn't, I don't know.
he genuinely felt bad, and I could tell. And it was sort of the same thing with Pyrocynical, where he made this video on this kid who did like a cringy Gary's Mod video, and his fan base ended up attacking the kid. And instead of, like, you know, just letting it be, Pyrocynical uploaded a video where, like, he dedicated like the first 5 minutes to say, like, hey, if you don't like this kid, it's fine, just don't fucking go and harass him, and if you genuinely like his content, you know, support him.
That was the problem with the commentary community, was that the people that it attracted, it wasn't the creators themselves, it was the people that they attracted, who were just incredibly, you know, immature and
one-sided. God, remember the fucking hiss thing?
Oh, God. Hiss. No, don't even. If, you're just, if you hiss, look at this profile image right here, all right? We don't hiss, we ribbit in this household. We ribbit. Ribbit. It's Rana, boys, from
guys?
Minecraft In-Dev.
Brand new video, well, on the goddamn internet.
I remember I had a friend who said that I sounded exactly like Leafy, and I wasn't sure how to feel about that. Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome to another video on the goddamn internet, and today...
Hey, guys.
Hey, Mandy. Hey, Graham. Perfectly balanced as all things should be, yo.
God, I actually changed my my name to Leafy's here on my Steam, and I'll go on the CS:GO.
Oh my God!
I'll put on my Leafy voice, and people will actually think I'm Leafy.
Guys?
Like,
hey, what's up, guys?
Hey, what's up, guys?
I'm coming back to YouTube. Don't worry.
You gotta get the stutter in there too. You gotta be like, like you're trying to start a car, like a dying car that you're trying to start. Hey, what's up, guys?
It's like a fucking sprinkler.
Yes. Hey, what's up, guys?
Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome back to a brand new video on the
goddamn internet. Oh no, he went offline again. Let's assess the issue right here. Oh, I am connected right now.